Welcome to episode 26 of my crafting podcast. This is my fortnightly vlog about knitting, crochet, yarn dyeing, spinning, sewing, anything else that seems like a good idea at the time. I'm coming to you from North Yorkshire in the north of England, where I live with my husband, our three daughters and two cats. You can find me on social media and on Instagram. I'm Mel Brown, crafting podcast, and on Ravelry I'm Funky40. And we also have a Ravelry group for this podcast, which you can find on the groups tab. Is that wonky? No, it's just the angle. I don't know. Right. Okay. So, episode 26. Let's have a look at where are they now. This is what happened to the projects you've already seen. So, only three works in progress last week. Is that right? I'm just going to check my little book. I've got my little book of all my notes here, look. Whip count was three. So yeah, only three works in progress last week. So let's have a look. The first one was the memory blanket. Now that, again, has had no action at all. But I'm missing it terribly. One of my friends is making a version of it where you've got blocks of nine, 3x3. Blocks of mitre squares and then a board around them, and she's making such progress, and I'm really, really wanted to get back to my blanket. So I might have said last time I podcast that I was going to do some of that between yeah, I'm going to try and pick that up again. Okay, so that's still in progress. The lefty is the next thing. This is a pattern by Martina Bain. You long-suffering watchers have seen this a lot. And you've not got much new to see, actually. Where's my little marker to say where I was when I spoke to you last? Oh dear. It's there, look. I've only not even done another whole repeat, but I have started knitting with, this is a single. So this is fibre that I have actually spun myself. It's not meant to break like that. Where's the other end of it? Oh no, that's okay, it's all right. That was where I started. This is where I'm actually working at the moment. So I spun this myself. As you can see, it's fairly far from being perfect. Actually, I can probably draft that some more right here. That's a bit mad. So that's the first hand spun that's made its way into the pattern so far. There's a bit of hand dyed here. So this is a really gorgeous pattern that's gonna come around like that, around the neck. And each of these is a different leftover sock yarn. It's beautiful, I just love it. It's taking longer than I expected, but I just keep distracting myself. It's not at the stage yet where I think, I need to get that off the needles. So, must be about 5 or 6 petals from the 29 which she recommends, but I've got another ball. How much have I got left of that ball? This is the first ball of the background yarn, which is this Chester Wool Company. You long sufferers have seen this a lot, you must be getting bored of it now. Sorry, I'll finish it soon. So, yeah, that is a lovely pattern, really well written, really elegant, easy to follow. I take it everywhere with me. This bag is going to need a wash. Or is that just fibre? This goes everywhere. And it's, yeah, starting to show signs of it, poor thing. Right, okay, so that's work in progress number two. And the final work in progress that you've seen before is Janelle. This is a crochet project from this lovely book from Dora Orenstein. It is colourful. So I've actually finished the body. So I think all the ends are running. Here it is. Oh, my arm's on quite long enough. That's better. See, that's better. So that's the back. It needs a bit of blocking. So it is looking rather fabulous. It doesn't fit very well over the top of this top. Needs a little bit of blocking. I need to put the sleeves on, obviously. My daughters think it would be great without the sleeves, but no, I think it needs the sleeves. The colours I've got for the sleeves, ooh, let me show you. 1, 2, 3, 4, is that it? No, 5. There we go. Not in that order though, no? So, imagine this with those as sleeves. It's going to be amazing. So yeah, really pleased with the way that's going. It's lovely. It's got this stitch linked double treble, which looks a lot like Tunisian crochet. So this here is one stitch. So you pick up a loop in each of these and in the existing. So it's kind of like an applied stitch. And then you come backwards, dropping off two loops, over two loops all the way back, two loops. So it's a lot like Tunisian crochet, but you don't need a special hook. And it's beautiful. So that is brilliant. I'm looking forward to starting the sleeves on that. So that's the three you've already seen. There's one new whip on the block, but it's not a whip. It's a new finished object on the block. Do you remember I told you that my friend Andrea, she's the lady who does all my blocking queen, she gave me some fibre, 300 grams of beautiful alpaca and merino and silk fibre. It's absolutely beautiful. I don't think I've got a picture of the fibre, but I've got a picture of the yarn here. And I decided to make it into another Quaker yarn stretcher boomerang. So I'd made one of those for me with my first hand spun. I'm casting around for it now, but I've put it somewhere else. I've hardly had it off my neck since I first made it, but so I made one for her as well in that yarn. I used all of the fiber and all the yarn for that. I'll just put in some pics here, including a pic of Andrea herself wearing it. Hello. This reminds me of Vlogmas. It's fun. Just wanted to record a quick segment about the fibre that my friend Andrea gave me. It's this, and it was browns and greys, 300 grams of it. Absolutely gorgeous, the loveliest fibre I've ever held, and I so enjoyed spinning it. Here's a picture of the yarn. And I'm going to show you this now ahead of time, because this is me on Sunday rather than Monday, which is when I'm recording the podcast, because I wanted to show you this. I finished it. I have made, oh, it smells very sheepy, it's lovely. I have made another of the Quaker yarn stretcher shawls, but in this, and it's absolutely gorgeous. I'll just pop it on. You've seen my the first one I made, which is in the multicolours. So here it is. It's absolutely gorgeous and it's so snuggly. So I'm going tomorrow morning to see Andrea to drop this off, and then I'll get a picture of her wearing it, and maybe she'll even let me film her for the podcast. So I'll time travel back to Monday now, and I'm done. Right, that's all the knitting and crochet. So if that's all you're here for, I'll see you next time. Okay, so let's do some yarn dyeing. Well, actually not just yarn dyeing. I try to use the word, avoid using the word dyeing, because obviously it has more than one use. So I did some dyeing. I bought some fibre from John Arbon. You saw this last time, just undyed Corriedale. So I dyed it. I'll put in some pics of the process here. So I dyed, I put in teal, Wilton's icing colour stuff, teal and golden yellow. I wanted to do teal and grey, but I didn't have a grey, I had a black, and it was really grainy and horrible. It was awful. It didn't soak into the yarn at all. It just sat in speckles and I had to wash it out. So after the teal, I put in a bright yellow. And this is what I got. So you can see somewhere where the bits where the teal has struck on its own, but most of it, that's where the yellow struck on its own, but most of it is kind of mixtures of the two. So a whole variety of shades of green. So yeah, really not at all what I was expecting or what I planned, but actually lovely. And you know, I don't actually try, I try not to have a plan for my dyeing because you know, I don't want to be disappointed. Some bits of white left over as well. So I spun this, this is half of it. The other half is around here somewhere. Ah, there it is, on the bobbin. So, colour's not so good because that's kind of whitish, a bit of a yellow or green. So you can see the all the colours in there, and you can see that my spinning's actually, apart from this bit here, which is obviously, the rest of it's fairly uniform. There's some highly over twisted bits. It's a little bit here. I don't know if you better see this, but look at how over twisted that is. But that's the joy of being a new spinner. So this becomes this, and this was the first hand dyed fibre that I'd spun. So I was really, really happy with this, and I'm going to make singles. That's what it's called for those of you who don't spin. This is called singles. You can knit with it if it happens to be balanced enough, but it's probably a bit twisty still. So I'll spin this into another one of these, and then I'll put the two of them together, ply them together, twisting in the other direction to make yarn. So really, really happy with that. I'm calling that colourway Daffodil, which is very apt because spring has struck a little early here. Bearing in mind this time last year, we still had two heavy snowfalls to come. It feels like spring. It may yet not be, but it feels like it. So daffodils are up. Really, really happy with this. I hadn't dyed fibre before. I was worried I would felt it, but don't seem to have done. So that was great. Right. I was gifted some fibre by a lady who I'll tell you a bit more about in a moment. And I don't know what fibre it is, but it was a lot of it and it was undyed. Well, not for long. So me and my daughter, my youngest daughter, Annie, we had a bit of a dyeing day on, I think it was Saturday morning. She had a birthday party on Saturday afternoon, so we spent the morning dyeing fibre. So I dyed, this is about 60 grams of unknown fibre. And this, we're calling the fire colourway, mostly because she liked it so much, she was busy trying to make her version of it when she managed to set fire to a dishcloth, which was quite impressive. Luckily it didn't do any damage to her or anything else. So I haven't spun any of that yet. That I'm looking forward to doing. I'm a bit of a mess with this, haven't I? But anyway, that's going to be a lovely colourway. But the other one that I dyed, the other half of that, I have actually already spun and plied. And here it is. Let me show you a quick picture of it in the fibre. And this is it in the yarn. So it was a chocolate brown and Wilton's violet and royal blue, and yeah, and some undyed parts as well, as you could see. So it looks lovely. I don't know, as I say, what fibre it is, but it feels nice and soft. So after making the Quaker yarn stretcher, which was perfect because you could just spin some yarn of any thickness, any colours, whatever, and then just add it into the pattern. It was brilliant. I wanted something else, a pattern like that, but I don't want to make another yarn stretcher that I can't take that one off, so I don't want to have another one. But I've come across a pattern called Less is More, which is the cardigan version of it. So the designer had said that When she started spinning, you could usually only get 100 grams of any one fiber. So she had sort of 100 gram balls of fiber of different colors and different batches and whatever. So she designed this cardi jacket thing, pattern, to use up those bits. And I'm gonna do that. So it's going to be almost as colorful, I think, as my Janelle, but it'll just be the bits and pieces. So we'll have, this will be part of it and this will be part of it. It'll all be beautifully mad. And it'll be my first hand-spun garment. It's knitted, I think, so it might take a while. But so I'm just collecting skeins for that. You know that red and pink stuff that I put into stash and quite surprised myself? That'll go in it too, won't it? And you know what? Those blue and purple ones I did, one's being gifted and the other one isn't, so that can go in as well. So all of this stuff can go in together. Be fabulous. And, oh, I'll tell you in a second. So, while I was doing all this, my youngest daughter was dying as well. Now, let me just show you. This is a perfect example of her personality. Sorry for the crinkling. While I was doing those none too subtle colourways, she dyed, oh my giddy aunt, this. So she had 100 grams of fibre. I don't know what this one is either. And this. And this was what she did when she set fire to things, because she had one in one pan, one in the other, and so that the fiber wasn't touching the hot metal in between, I'd put a dishcloth over the two saucepans and it had managed to get itself onto the flame. So and then she did individual, oh, that's another one of those individual pieces. These are all individual pieces in different colors. So that is so typical of my quirky genius and her way of approaching things. She got an idea from what I did and she went off and did it her own way. And I don't know if she's ever going to spin these, but as you know, if you watched last time, she's just been diagnosed with autism spectrum. So she's Asperger's and Aspie. And that means that she has different focus to neurotypical, normal people. So she was hyper focused on this long after I'd moved on to watch the rugby. She was still in there dyeing yarn. That's why she set fire to the dishcloth on her own. And she's made this amazing thing. Now, that she ever gets to spin with it, doesn't actually matter, because we had so much fun together. And if she doesn't spin with it, I will. And then I can make it into something for her, or she can just keep the yarn. Doesn't matter. The thing is, she had a wonderful time. And sometimes she took the fibre out and the fibre wouldn't take on any more dye, but the water had still some dye in it, wasn't exhausted. So I had just been watching videos from one of my favourite YouTubers, who is Rebecca from Chemnitz. If you've dyed any yarn or interested in dyeing any yarn or fibre, Rebecca from Chemnitz, I'll put a link. Oh, I didn't say that, did I? Anything I talk about, I'll put a link to it down below. You click across, it'll take you to Ravelry, and there'll be clickable links to everything. So Rebecca from Chemnitz was just saying that she was in the middle of an experiment and something wasn't going as she was expecting, and she wanted to soak up some extra dye, so she just chucked in a skein of undyed yarn. Well, I thought, I'll just do that. So I did that, and then there was some dye left in a different colour, so I dipped the end of a skein in that, and then I basically messed about using up all of her leftover dye, and this is the result. How subtle is that? Well, for me, that is immensely subtle. So this was the first colour I did, and it was just a kind of tonal kind of, what do you call that? I can't think of the word they use. Anyway, that, and then I dipped this end in the next colour. So that's subtle number one. Then there's subtle number two. I love it. I really, really love it. And then there's subtle number three. Green at one end, yellow at the other end, and white in the middle. I don't know how that'll translate into how many stitches and how many rows in socks, but I don't know, I don't care. I am finding, this is something really interesting. I'd introduce you to Annie.
Belle, hey.
Yeah, she's changed her name to Belle, because she's Annabelle. But anyway, is that it?
Yeah, basically.
That's it, right.
Nice.
Where was I? Yeah, I've developed quite firm tastes in sock yarn and other yarn about how I like the colours to go. I don't like speckles, I don't like rapid colour changes because I like the colour change. I like gradients, or you know, a few rows of one colour then a few rows of the next. I don't like it to change much within the row. And that's my been my taste up till now. But since I started dyeing my own yarn, I've noticed that my tastes have changed. So like this one, as I was saying, I wouldn't typically buy this because I know, let me unwrap the skein. I'm not very good at wrapping skeins, but I know that when you knit with this, there's going to be a few stitches of green and a few stitches of white and a few stitches of yellow and then white. And that might not even be a whole row, so it's certainly not going to get stripes or anything like that. And it has a possibility of just making a weird pattern that I might not like. But with hand dyed, I don't seem to mind that as much. I'm not that bothered. And then when it comes to hand spun, I'm even less fussy, because there is actually no way in the world that I would buy something like that, because I'm not a particularly big fan of marled stuff, and it isn't one colour or another. It's not even, you know, colours rapidly shifting. It's two colours within the yarn rapidly shifting, and I would never buy that. But I absolutely love it because I dyed it myself and I spun it myself. And again, with this one, the colour changes are going to be fairly random. I would not buy a yarn that even had this. Well, actually, I don't know how long those repeats are, but I might not choose to buy a yarn that had this long repeats. But once I've plied it with itself, who knows what it's going to look like. It'll have green bits, it'll have yellow bits, it'll have green and yellow bits, it'll have yellow and white bits. I wouldn't choose to buy that, but I'm going to love it when I've spun it. So yeah, that was the point I was making, that my taste in yarn that I've dyed and I've spun, or both, is completely different to that in which I buy commercially, or you know, ready-made. It's interesting. So that was dyeing. Let's do spinning. Actually, you've pretty much seen all the spinning, but I want to tell you that I met a lady at the Spinners, Dyers and Weavers Guild, not in that order, and she was selling a spinning wheel. Now, as you know, I rented one from the guild. Absolutely brilliant. If you Google there at the local, if you're interested in starting spinning, have a look at the local WSD. So it's Weavers, Spinners, Dyers, Guilds, Association of, whatever. They have meetings. They seem to be on a Saturday morning once a month. And I went along and I rented a wheel for £3 a month. Bearing in mind that new, they cost £700 to £1,000, and second hand you're looking at a minimum of 150, usually probably more than 200. So pretty good deal really. And I rented one. It was an Ashford Traveller, and I brought it home and called it Wendy, and it was lovely. And I need to return that, obviously, and I wanted to get my own. So this lady that I met at the guild, Cherry, she sold me her Ashford Traditional. So I went to pick it up on Friday last week, and as well as getting that, it also came with a Lazy Kate, which for those of you who haven't seen one, is a little stand with three bobbins on it, so you can keep them rolling. You can ply from it, you can keep it rolling, and while you etc. What else? I got some hand carders, and some this fibre that I've been dyeing, and me and Bella have been dyeing, and also, what else? Some fleece. So absolutely wonderful, a collection of stuff I brought home. It's very, very exciting. Right, the draw for the bag. Oh, I better go get the bag. Hang on. So the hook along. On Christmas Eve, we started a hook along, so anybody who wanted to could start a crochet sock. What I did is I made a note to everybody who started or had a go, I got a list of six. There were six people plus me who had commented in the thread. And so I've got a list of those, and what I'm going to do, I made this. I still haven't tied off the ends, believe it or not, but I will probably post it. So it's a lovely little drawstring bag, just big enough for a pair of socks. And it's lined. And I'm going to send that to whoever wins that draw. And I've got a random number generator here. I'm not very good at this thing. So it's 1 to 6 and it's going to go... Oh, 5. Right, where's my list? The list says... Fabric Crazy. Ah, that is Adriana, who is my friend in Kansas. All of these are friends of mine. Well, pretty much everyone who gets in contact over the podcast ends up being a friend. So this is Adriana in Kansas. So I will send that bag out to you, Adriana. We'll be in contact anyway. And you can give me your address and I'll post that out to you. That was fun. Right. Next. So an update on Creative Escape. So I run knitting and crochet retreats in Harrogate in North Yorkshire. And I've already told you that I have one in April, 1st to 4th of April. And there's still some spaces on that. That is at the Cairn Hotel. That's a lovely 3-night retreat. But I have also just booked at the Cairn 2 Learn to Crochet days. So these are days for people who haven't crocheted before or haven't crocheted for a while and their skills are rusty or just want to come along and just have a bit of input, really. It's going to be a 9 to 4 day in Harrogate at the Cairn Hotel, Saturday the 4th of May or Friday the 24th of May. We're going to have tuition all day. You're going to get your hook and some yarn and a pattern and lunch, teas and coffees, a lovely sunny room and lots of good company. And that's going to be £60. So if you want to come along to that, and if you're local, because a lot of you aren't, if you want to come along to that, just comment somewhere or let me know or whatever. I'll put the website up here. So I'm also going to do an introduction to spinning, drop spindles and things, just trying to iron out the details, because we're going to do it at Potts, Painting Potts in Knaresborough. So if you're local and you want to get in touch about that, do.
Okay.
Right. Taking a leaf out of Starry Eyes Ali's book. That's the Little Drops of Wonderful podcast. And I'm just, that's the crafting stuff over. I'm just going to have a little bit of a personal update now. So if you've had enough of crafting, that's all you need, then just I'll see you in a couple of weeks. So I told you last week that my youngest daughter, that was Annie that you saw very briefly there. She's decided she wants to be known as Belle now because her name is Annabelle. And we deliberately gave all three of our daughters names that they could change and become something slightly different if they wanted to, if they grew up, and she has. So if you hear me say Annie or Belle, that's the same person. So last week she was diagnosed with Asperger's, and things are going really, really well since then. It's just it's helped everything, helped us so much to understand what's going on with her. She's been different for a long, long time, and now we know why, and we also now know how to help her to cope with that. So it's absolutely brilliant. I'm still getting up at 5 o'clock in the mornings, and that is still working really well. And you know what? I have had seasonal depression, so winter depression, ever since I had my first baby 18 years ago. And I had postnatal depression, then I had antenatal depression, and seasonal ever since. But actually this year, I really haven't suffered at all. I had one day where I was a bit low, really a bit low, and that was it. And I don't know whether it's a HRT, I've been on HRT since the end of December, or whether it's kind of indirectly that, because I've noticed that my mental state is very, very linked to my my energy levels. Sorry, interruption, it's half term here. I find it very hard to be positive when I'm tired. And I find it very hard not to be happy when I've got lots of energy. So it may be that the HRT, which has made me feel less tired, is indirectly helping my seasonal adjustment. It may be new interests. It may be having the yarn dyeing and the spinning and all this kind of stuff going on that's keeping me going. But I don't know. It's been a very mild winter as well, but I don't know if that's part of it, I don't know. But I have definitely been much better this year than I've ever been since having children, and that's amazing. That's more or less it for me. So, if you've enjoyed the video, then do please click the thumbs up. And if you would like to see more, I record every 2 weeks, then subscribe and hit the little bell so that you get updates. And if you want to see the patterns or the links to anything I've talked about, click on below and it will take you across the Ravelry. You can join the group there, or you don't have to. Comment, give me some feedback on this thread here underneath, or on Ravelry, or private message me, whatever you like. So, thanks for watching, and I'll catch you in a couple of weeks. Bye.